We're picking up where the last vlog left, just as we were about to enter the Moremi Game Reserve. The Moremi Game Reserve covers one third of the entire Okavango Delta, and it's home to one of Botswana's densest concentrations of wildlife. During our stay here, we set out for game drives every morning and evening, when animals are most likely to show themselves. In Ronald and Vivian's car, we traversed the narrow tracks and pathways that crisscross the reserve, in search of a glimpse of an animal. And we didn't get disappointed. Lots of animals showed themselves. Antelope, many of them, especially impala, were the most common species in Botswana. Warthogs, that usually appear in small groups and look quite funny with their tails straight up in the air. Hornbills, the iconic African bird with their long orange beaks. And of course, the African elephant, the largest land animal on Earth. Viewing these immense creatures in the wild was incredible. We even saw a group of wild dogs, which are endangered and apparently quite rare to see. We spotted them just lying in the middle of the road, having a snooze. Even beside wildlife, it was just amazing to be in the delta. Being one of the few inland river deltas in the world, this is such a unique place. The sudden abundance of water turns the region into a beautiful green paradise, in such sharp contrast with the rest of the arid country. Looking out over the many rivers and marshes, or watching the sunset over the plains, was very special. The nights in the Moremi were an experience on itself. This is the time when most animals are active, and as it gets dark, the surroundings start to fill with the sounds and cries of different animals. The campsites in the reserves are not fenced in any way, so animals can literally walk right past your tent. And they do. It was quite exciting and a bit scary to hear the loud calls, grunts, and eating noises of different animals in the middle of the night. Our most thrilling and scary experience happened on our last day in the Moremi. I was driving, following an especially narrow path surrounded by thick bush on both sides. When we turned around a corner, we suddenly found ourselves amidst a group of about 10 elephants, including two babies. They were only meters away and I immediately realized we were in trouble. The matriarch of the group, in order to protect the babies, came walking towards us while trumpeting and violently waving her ears. There was no room to turn around at all, so I had to switch back in reverse and drove backwards for about 100 meters, until the elephant stopped following us. It was a close call. On day 8 of our trip, we left the Moremi and returned to Maun, once again following the long, bumpy dirt road. We spotted more elephants, including another baby. And we also had a little dance party with a chameleon in the middle of the road.
So we need some better beats. It's going down. I'm yelling timber. You better move. You better dance. It's about to go down.
From Maun, we made another day trip to Boro, a tiny hamlet at the end of one of the delta's many fingers. From here, we went on a boat trip along the Boro River, together with a local guide from Boro. The boats, which are traditionally made out of hollowed out tree trunks, are called Mokoro. Nowadays, they use mostly fiberglass Mokoros, which last much longer. The ride along the river was beautiful, and it gave us an idea of the sheer size of the delta. The river was quite overgrown, and we literally had to be pushed through all of the reeds. Our Mokoro guides told us that normally paths get created due to the many boats that pass through, but lately they have had very few visitors. In normal years, about 100,000 tourists visit the delta every year, but right now, because of COVID, there are barely any people. For us, this meant we had most of the places to ourselves, which was nice. But for the tourism industry, of course, it isn't, and many people are without work because of it. In any case, we had a very nice day. Our guides were friendly and knowledgeable, especially Terence, who knew everything. Halfway, we moored the Mokoros and went for a small hike along the river. Near the end, we even got to try steering the Mokoros ourselves, using the long poles. But this was surprisingly difficult. The final 2 days of the trip were reserved for the ride back home, which was quite a long one, nearly 1,000 kilometers. We split it up halfway and stayed near Nata, a town at the edge of the salt pans. This is a huge area that was once, thousands of years ago, part of an enormous lake. When the lake dried up, several huge flat plateaus stayed behind, rich in salt. In the rainy seasons, these pans can fill up with water again, which was the case right now. The Sua pan, which we visited, was completely full of water, and it looked more like an ocean. We spent our last day here and even spotted some more wild beasts. During the final evening, we watched the sunset over the Sua pan, which was absolutely magical and a great end of the trip. We had an unforgettable trip, and we can't wait to see even more of the country. We do realize how fortunate we are right now to be able to travel so much, while much of the world is still in lockdown. Hopefully this will become possible for everyone again in the months to come. Meanwhile, we'll keep telling you about our adventures in Botswana, so stay tuned.